Ladies and gentlemen, we've already done our, somewhat of our introduction. But I want to formally introduce you to our speaker on insurance and a strong member of the Chamber of Commerce. And I'd like to thank a supporter of our program as well, Tom Wydell. Let's welcome and thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, it's an honor. I was here a year ago and I sat on a panel of two of my colleagues and listened to business plans of the group was in here at that time. I don't know if some of you were in here at that time or not, but it was just, you guys were in an awesome program. I'll just let you know that. I'm your local Good Neighbor State Farm agent. And I started with State Farm February 1st, 1973, so a couple of years ago. So I've been doing this a while. I've been was an agent. I went into management where I was a frontline recruiter and basically brought people into State Farm and gave them, you know, talked to them about the opportunity to become a whole business person. Because this is, like you see McDonald's, a lot of people look at McDonald's on the street and you say, that's a franchise operation. Well, each State Farm agency is a franchise operation. So I'm an independent business person. I just contracted right insurance and financial services through State Farm Insurance. To give you an idea how the business has grown, we got our first computers in 1981. So that was several years ago. The computers that you have today on your iPhone or BlackBerry or whatever are more powerful than any of those computers. They had rooms of computers back then and are more powerful today. So you can imagine the information stream that comes right now. So that is our constant challenge, to stay updated. Do you all have iPhones or clone or, you know, what's the other one? You guys. Anyway, so the information stream you're doing with emails and Facebook and I guess Twitter and all that kind of stuff, it's instantaneous messages. So that's the biggest change today. And it's constantly changing and evolving. So the biggest challenge today is to stay up on top of that. And it's hard for somebody like me who started with just paper and just simple books to deal with people, but I'm used to dealing with people face-to-face, eyeball to eyeball. And I hope that in your career and in your life is that you develop a little bit of that, because of course technology is fantastic, but don't lose sight of the people you're doing it for. That's the key. That's the key of the whole thing. When you talk about insurance, what I do is I focus on what people need. It's not what I think they need. It's not what some, maybe they read it on an informational blog or something like that, that says, well, you need to consider this, this, and this. My thing is that what happens if you come to work tomorrow and the fire department's putting the fire out? So when I deal with insurance, that's what I ask people. I ask them whether they've been in business for their brand new, because it's not my property, it's their property. And I don't have a clue of what they own, other than just sitting there and say, what, this and this and this and this, what do you think that's worth? I don't know what they pay for. So it's really pretty much about what would it take to put them back in business and make them whole again at some point in time in the future. Maybe they have to change locations, they have to buy, new equipment, new computers. And the downtime for business today because of computers isn't as much as it used to be. So that's one of the things that we're dealing with today. What happens if somebody walks into your business and slips and falls? Who's liable? Who do you guys think is liable? I'm sorry, what?
Yeah,
wet floor. A wet floor? How about, I've had restaurants that have salad bars and people slip and fall on tomatoes, of all things, on the floor. Or cucumbers. Crazy stuff. So you as a business owner, you want to be protected for that. They can run into the thousands, if not tens of thousands, in some cases hundreds of thousands of dollars. That's what insurance protects you for. Same thing with your business property. In addition to that, what happens? How long do you think they'll be out of work? So I talked to them about that. You know, I would talk to you about that. So these are all things you need to consider, and we just have this general conversation. Over time, you develop your word track. So I happen to be in, people would think insurance, when you're selling insurance. Well, not really, I'm providing insurance. And my number one goal with my clients is to educate them. Mm-hmm. Not educate them to the formal education that I had, but educate them enough so that they can start thinking about, oh, okay, I get it now. I need to, what did I pay for this stuff? What would it cost to buy it new? Do I have to have somebody deliver it? So I need a little bit more coverage for the delivery charges and the setup charges and all that kind of stuff. And then, what are my assets? Now, if you're just starting out in business, you're looking at your, you're thinking, I don't have a lot of assets. You know, I haven't really made it yet. You know, you have to have a certain amount of capital to start up your business. But you really, you know, maybe you don't own a home yet. Maybe you're just renting. You know, you're driving a little meter car, that kind of thing. And that's where a lot of us started. So, but you have to look out, you have to be able to do a little bit of forward thinking. Not that you have to insure for things that you don't have yet, but you just have to maybe come up with a plan. So what we do a lot of times is say, oh, let's talk about the things, irregardless of what you have, what are the things that are important to you? So we talk about what's important to them, bring up things like, we have property insurance, liability insurance. What about life insurance? What about disability insurance? How about health insurance? Auto insurance. You know, there's business auto. Maybe you have a truck that you need to make deliveries with. So you have to insure that. Who's going to drive the truck? You have employees, so now we have to cover them. What's called workers' compensation law insurance to satisfy that law. So because if your employees are injured on the job, who's responsible?
You.
You, yeah. So we try to do all those things. We take a look at it as a whole and just come up with a plan, have an understanding, and then maybe have some basic insurance with maybe a review 6 months or a year down the road or 2 years down the road and come back and address it again. Why? Why would you do that? Anything?
Save money.
Hmm?
Save money?
Well, it could be cost savings involved, but probably the biggest thing is what I did when I talked about when I first started talking. Things are changing and they're changing rapidly. And so does everything stay the same? Not really. You know, it's constantly evolving, constantly changing. And then, you know, maybe you get married along the way, maybe you have children. In my case, then you start having grandchildren. So it's always evolving, always changing. So if everything stayed the same, then great. You know, it doesn't really change anything, but that's not really what it is. Okay. What else happens along the way? Part of it that could affect businesses.
Someone could have said, you know,
the
business that you've insurance. For the reason that someone may fall or something and they might want to sue your business, mm-hmm. just to get money out of it.
Right.
And that's
what yeah. All that kind of thing. Maybe you're making a new product that you weren't making a year or two before. Is that going to change the liability aspects of your business? So that's why you get back and you stay in touch. Okay? Make sure the amounts. Do things cost more today? think is one of the other biggest challenges faced by business? More specifically, what's probably one of the biggest challenges that you as a business person might face?
Let's take a moment to really think about that and respond. Tom's got a lot of experience right here. We should take advantage of Tom. And so, Tom, tell me again the question, and let's see if we can retrieve what we need.
My thought is that what can you do? What do you need to do as a business person to stay in front of that? What is a constant thing that you have to
keep the fence closed? Keep your enemies closer.
I'm sorry.
Keep your fence closed, but keep your enemies closer.
So what are some of the situations that...
Where are you guys right now? Let's put it this way. What are you guys doing right now?
We're letting
you
know what
we're doing. What do you do during the daytime right now?
School.
Go to school! And so just because you did a college degree, just because you have a business that's doing well, you're constantly educating yourself. There are certain laws as far as my field goes, as far as, because we not only deal with insurance, we deal with securities and life insurance and things like that. So we have things called continued education. And we have new products and new things that are changing within our industry. So we have to kind of stay up on that to make sure that our clients know about that if it fits in with what they need. So it's always reassessing client needs, talking to them about that, and just kind of staying on top of it. So school doesn't stop when you graduate, okay? And so I've been doing this what? So 73, you do the math. So a couple of years into this, 43 years. And we still have to do the continuing education. We still have to study. We still have to go back and make sure that we understand what's going on. So it doesn't stop. Basically, one of the biggest challenges is that when you do, will you be doing business plans and things like that down the road?
Yes, we're starting our business plans now.
Okay, awesome. So, do you just make the one business plan and that's it, you think? No, we revise that every year because things change. So, you might have new people in your office. You might have, in my case, you might. Do we need to get so-and-so licensed? Do we need to maybe send them off to a certain school and make sure they get trained properly? Do we bring people into the business and maybe let them sit with them and they're experts in certain areas to assist them with the technology and the products and services that they have? Does that make sense? Things changing from all the time. There are certain things that don't change. It is basically who you are. So, what type of person would you want to do business with? Anybody have any ideas?
Like the character of the person?
Exactly. Have any thoughts on that? Or from a teacher, since we're all in school right now, so when you look at a teacher, when you look at maybe a coach or your English teacher or a math teacher, what kind of an attribute do you want in that person? Do you want somebody who's just kind of like, hey, let's just kind of hang out and talk about stuff later? Do you want somebody who gets down to it, has fun with you, but on the other hand, is serious about it, and you talk about that? So what kind of qualities would that be? Educated? Good one. I'm sorry, what?
Reliable.
Oh, maybe. Huge.
Overall, a leader.
Oh, man. I don't even know if I'm resilient. Resilient, you know? I don't feel, sometimes I think I don't flex back good enough. Loyal, awesome. correctly. Trustworthy? Did you look at my notes? So basically, it all boils down to the golden rule. When you do business with people, anybody know what the golden rule is?
Code of honor.
Code of honor, okay? What's the golden rule? That's it. Do unto others as you would want them to do unto you. Number one. It's not about you, it's about them. And if you can do that, do you do it all the time? No. Because we're human, you know? We screw up. So that's why if people, I'll just tell you right now, if people didn't mess up, if, you know, they say two errors, but if people didn't make errors or have accidents, I wouldn't be doing this as a career. I'd be back doing my chemistry or lab work or a doctor somewhere, or whatever, that's what I was, that's what my degree is in chemistry. So there you go. I'm a chemistry major, a chemist doing selling insurance and providing insurance services. Have you been introduced to good positive thinking type of material? So what I'm going to encourage you to think about is that as you grow in your lives and as you grow in business, and hopefully you'll be fortunate enough to have a successful business someday, and you have to really work at it, but some of the key elements from successful people, and I went online today and downloaded, there's all kinds of stuff in there, but the traits and qualities of successful people, just Google it, and you'll be surprised what you come up with. But the people that came up on here, a lot of the people that I've listened to, seen videos, and I'll just share a couple of them with you. You be honest in your dealings, treat others as you want them to treat you. But one of the key things as far as, and I heard Susan Irwin mention earlier that show up. One of the keys to successful people is that you develop a resilient or consistent way of doing things. And one of those is that when you show up on time. Not 5 minutes late, not 1 minute late, not even on the time. I went to a seminar with a very successful person one time and said, if you're not early, you're late. So think about that. It's just to kind of coin that in your mind. The other thing is that when you show up, be ready to work. You know? So you show up, you sit down, you get all the stuff out of the way, and basically when I call it, when the clock strikes 9 is when my office actually opens for business every day. The flag goes up and everything's off and running. To coin a phrase, incorporate something like that. It's just so that's when that's when we got to be ready to go, because that's when people expect us to be ready to go. So you show up on time, and then get to work. And then what you do down the road is you go back and you review it to make sure what you were doing makes sense. So anybody in scouting here? And scouts or whatever. We used to do something in Boy Scouts called Roses, Buds, and Thorns. Girl Scouts, whatever, brownies. But work?
Yeah.
Awesome. So we did something every time we had an event or a camp out or a hike. It doesn't matter what we did. Maybe we were involved in a civic event or something like that. Okay, what went right, what went wrong, and what can we do better next time? So you go through those roses, buds, and thorns kind of a procedure, and it's kind of a SWOT, you know. What went really good, what didn't go so hot, what can we do better? So that's important as well. But if you remember just the one thing, boost yourself. You know? So always be able to look at the guy or the girl in the mirror and just, you know, and smile and just say, okay, I'm doing the best I possibly can. and nobody can ask for more. That's pretty much it. Do we have any other questions?
Go ahead and ask questions,
class. What influenced you to become what you are now?
What I'm doing right now? You know, when I was young, when I was in my 20s, I can't say I had a whole... I was confident enough. I played sports, and I stuck through and got through college. And my dad was probably one of my best mentors in my life. And he was an accountant. He said, you know what? I've got a couple of clients who are State Farm agents, at that time. And they make a decent income. And he goes, I think you're a lot smarter than them. So here's the one man in my life that thought I was a pretty smart guy. And God bless him, that was really what made me think about it. There you go. You show up and help people and take care of them and be honest and always put their needs first, and that's how I got here today. The other thing I'll do is I'm active in my community and my church. So I like to give back, or I call it paying forward.
Isn't there changes in the insurance industry that are taking place now that have really, in your lifetime, never taken place at the speed that it's taking?
Well, it's daily.
Yeah, and I'm saying it's a requirement that with a lot of people, the baby boomers, starting to be the, of where, students like this could be. That's, I guess that's what we were trying to say.
Yeah. Pushes me is passion, and I would say so. Passion for what I do, and probably the passion of caring for other people. What happens over time, a lot of my clients, they're family. They don't come in and shake hands, oh, hi Tom, how you doing? We give hugs. I haven't seen them in a long time. If they went through a tough family thing or whatever, you cry with them if they lost a loved one or something like that. Part of the deal is I take clients too. And some of the clients are pretty nasty. And if you hold them and talk to them, and what else can you do? So the passion of helping people, that's probably the one thing that drives me. Support people, technicians, designers. It's still just a really booming, growing field, and there's new stuff coming all the time. So that's, yeah, absolutely. Does that answer your question?
So we're almost out of time, but could you share with us what, in your view, whether for your own insurance practice, or as a business leader, or just observing a lot of people in business, for people starting off in businesses, whether they're going to be people that end up having medical practices, people that are going to sell a product on the eBay of some sort that has some liability for it, even people that are going to be fashion designers in their own business, could you do two things for us? Tell us maybe what kind of insurance needs you might look at in one of those environments. And also, what do you find the mistake is when people start those enterprises in terms of insurance? Not having enough, trying not to do it at all, or underestimating the liabilities? What would you be your answer for that?
No matter what the business is, all businesses have certain basic needs. Some might be specialized, like a physician's office, you know, a doctor's office. There's other needs other than just fire insurance, coverage on their business property and premises liability. How about malpractice insurance? Or in other fields like the technical services industry, what we call errors and omissions if you goof. You know, so those are things that are covered outside of, you know, standard business policy. So we think about those things. And I put them on the table. I just let, it's my job to let people know what's at risk of having a business. So if you start a business today, here's what I think you need to consider. And we'll plug in the amounts and we'll come up with a premium. But don't base your decision on the premium. Base your decision on the need. And then if we have an affordability issue, let's see how we can work it. We'll come up with a game plan of how we can incorporate it. You say, well, I just don't have money. You know, maybe the time to start the business is right now, but I'm not going to tell them that. I'm just saying, these are things that you really need, so let's come up and let's take a look at it, and as you grow in your business, then let's come back and do that. The one thing I see, there's two things I see. Number one is, not just for new businesses, but for established businesses, is that don't forget what brought you there. Hard work and discipline. Don't accept anything less of your employees that you wouldn't do yourself. So, is that kind of what you want to
know? That's great. Well, thank you so much. We appreciate having you.